From the studios of Farm Journal Broadcast, this is U.S. Farm Report.
Welcome to U.S. Farm Report. I'm Tyne Morgan, and here's what we're working on for you over the next 60 minutes. Traders expected the largest September corn stocks in a decade in the latest USDA report. We'll see if their projections held true. Donald Trump's ag advisor says if Trump's elected, he'll place a farmer or rancher at the helm of the EPA. As presidential hopefuls go head-to-head, trade gets caught in the middle. But why is it so vital?
We have ample quality supply. We don't have the demand that we need.
That's our Farm Journal report. And in John's world,
big rains need big grains.
U.S. Farm Report, brought to you by the dependable, long-lasting Chevy Silverado.
Now for the news that moved the markets this week. USDA hitting us with the quarterly grain stocks report Friday, with the trade expecting the largest September corn stocks number in a decade. Corn stocks as of September 1st coming in slightly higher than last year at 1.74 billion bushels. Now slightly below the average trade guess, but up from this time last year. Soybeans totaling 197 million bushels, also below what trade was expecting, but that number is 3% higher from last September. But look at those wheat stocks, 2.53 billion bushels, up 21% from a year ago. The report also showing on-farm corn stocks are up from last year, while soybeans stored on the farm, those are down 16% from a year ago. Mexico, the number two buyer of U.S. corn, announcing this week the fourth largest daily purchase of U.S. corn since the 70s. The total, more than 1.5 million metric tons. That's 62 million bushels. Of that 1.5 million, 1 million metric tons is for the 16 to 17 marketing year, and another 500,000 in the 17 to 18 year. Well, China is slapping an anti-subsidy duty to imports of U.S. dry distiller grains. The country issuing a final ruling this week claiming U.S. DDGs are being unfairly subsidized by the U.S. government, saying it's damaging China's DDG industry. The news came just weeks after the U.S. filed a complaint with the World Trade Organization accusing China of illegal government subsidies for rice, wheat, and corn. Despite feed yard margins improving $48 a head this week, one of Canada's largest feedlots is closing its gates. Alberta-based Western Feedlots says it will close its three feedlots that can handle 100,000 head total early next year. Western is blaming market conditions and a poor political environment. An Alberta, Canada feeding company says more cattle feeders will close in the next 6 months, which means more cattle will flood U.S. feed yards. Well, this was the scene in Cedar Falls, Iowa last week as farmers with harvest-ready crops play the waiting game to get back in the field. USDA's latest crop progress report showing harvest in the hardest-hit areas falling behind. Iowa corn harvest is just 4% complete, 7 points behind average. Minnesota, that's 3%, 6 points behind. Nationally, 15% of the crop is out of the field, trailing the average pace by 4 points. And soybean harvest, it's running a bit behind, but no major delays there. 10% is cut, 3 points behind average. Texas also hit with heavy rains. 11% of the cotton crop is harvested there, falling 4 points behind, but nationally, cotton harvest is right on track with average. All right, those are the headlines. Meteorologist Mike Hoffman joins us now with weather. Mike, heavy rains in Texas last week, as well as that northern Corn Belt area. So how does next week look for precip?
Tyne, looks like another slow-moving storm system for the upper Midwest, and we'll have to watch a potential tropical system off the East Coast. But in the meantime, here's the drought monitor. We continue to see the pocket in the southeast, parts of the northeast, and just west of the Black Hills area. Besides California, they've been in a drought, unfortunately, for a long period of time. But let's go back 1 month, and you can see how things have changed. Not a whole lot. Most of the areas that were dry have stayed dry. Most of the areas that were doing okay stayed okay, although some areas obviously were on the wet side, like we talked about parts of Wisconsin and Minnesota. So let's go day by day this week. Stationary front in Florida, still some spotty showers and thunderstorms on Monday. That lingering storm system that was over the eastern Corn Belt most of last week, finally, slowly getting out of here into the eastern Great Lakes. You can see another storm system coming in out west. This is going to be the big weather maker for the middle of the country as we head through Wednesday. You can see that already producing some widespread rains, parts of the central and eastern Rockies all the way up into southern Canada, scattered showers and thunderstorms southward from there. And I'm saying potential because the models are kind of all over the place. This could be a hurricane or tropical storm along the East Coast. I'm just showing it as an area of low pressure because I don't want to alarm people, but pay attention to it if you live in the mid-Atlantic states or the Northeast. Other than that, the big storm and now over the western Great Lakes with some showers back that way, thunderstorms into the southeast, and another storm system coming into the Pacific Northwest. We'll be back in our next half hour with a longer range forecast.
All right, thanks, Mike. Well, the quarterly grain stocks report just released Friday. We'll break it down with Chip Nellinger and Brian Doherty after the break.
Welcome.
Hi.
Today we're going to be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck. Nice. You want to grab that empty toolbox for me? Let's start here with the aluminum bed.
That's a big hole.
Huge.
We got Swiss cheese for a truck here.
I'm curious to see if that will do the same thing with the Chevy.
Well, let's find out. Same spot, same angle, same empty toolbox.
Took it way better.
The steel held up.
Silverado proved it is the toughest truck here.
What is the Corvus Zone? It's the one place where grass and broadleaf weeds don't stand a chance. It starts down here, where it counts, but only when you use Corvus, the one corn herbicide that delivers three levels of defense: burn down, residual, and reactivation with rain. You want season-long control of the toughest weeds, including resistant ones. Welcome to the Corvus Zone.
Corvus, the number one pre-emergence corn herbicide from Bayer.
Do you worry about your mom or dad living alone? I know I did. Hi, I'm Joan London, and there's a free service you need to know about. It's called A Place for Mom. They're the nation's largest senior living referral service, and they can help you find the right senior care fast.
Mom and Dad, we found this place. It's great. You can afford it. You're going to love it. Let's go look at it.
A Place for Mom offers free one-on-one advice from local advisors and a personalized list of senior living communities you can visit. Believe me, I know, I've been there. Finding senior care for a parent can be difficult, but now there's a place for answers, a place for mom.
If you're struggling to find reliable senior living information for your mom or dad, then call to get the free help you need during this turbulent time. Call now, 800-243-0190. 800-243-0190. Call 800-243-0190 today.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report. On the Marketing Roundtable with me this week, Brian Doherty of Stewart Peterson and Chip Nellinger of Blue Reef Agri-Marketing. Friday, USDA had their latest quarterly grain stocks report. Just to review the numbers real quick, corn stocks up slightly from last year, soybean stocks up 3%, wheat up 21%. From last year. It seems like this wheat number is the biggest one we need to swallow.
Yeah, it's but it's not a surprise. Right? Okay. We've known that the wheat stocks number is big. That was a hard pill to swallow, though, because we just can't get any help for the wheat market. And in longer term, that might hold the corn market back a little bit, too. But yeah, corn and beans, I thought were right in line. And, you know, if you go back and compare them to 14, 16 months ago, you know, $1.73 billion on corn ending stocks for old crop. What was it, $197 million on beans? You know, at one point we were fearing over a 400 million bushel bean carryout and over a 2 billion bushel corn carryout. So the demand's there. We're using a lot of bushels.
Yeah, and initially it was not a bearish reaction from trade. We were actually trading up right after the report.
Sure. The numbers are basically all news. They were as expected. No big changes. But here's the interesting. Let's call it factoid. Usage August or June through August was up significantly in corn, beans, and wheat. So what it is, it's a sign that low prices are curing low prices. In fact, soybean usage was up 55%. So that's a reflection of problems in the southern hemisphere with their crops, but also good demand, good exports. And so that old carryout number becomes the carry-in number, tightens things up a little bit, especially in corn and beans.
That feed and residual use number in that grain stocks report, some ahead of the report, Chip, thought maybe USDA was too aggressive on that number. It was not attainable. But what did this report show us with that?
Yeah, it showed us on old crop that they were pretty well right in line. And there was no big shock. I think the market, you know, with a little slump in corn prices ahead of the report, was maybe fearing that a little bit. But, you know, with the number being where it came out right, basically in line with expectations, I think the USDA was right on. I think there'll be a lot of debate going forward for several more months on whether their new crop corn feed and residuals right, with this big pile of old wheat stocks that we have. But from old crop perspective, I think it looks like they're right on line.
Do you think that USDA could be even more aggressive with their number, considering our large herd that we have?
I think if you look over in the slaughter numbers, you see big numbers there, and they're eating something, and corn especially is the commodity of choice. So when I see these feed numbers, I'm not surprised. I wouldn't necessarily expect that the USDA is going to raise these numbers, but I think they've got it right this time.
Okay.
And when you look at that, where we're at right now, it tells us that low prices are curing low prices. We're cheap in value. And you're going to see good demand develop out of this.
Yeah, that's promising. Looking at the on-farm stocks in this report, showing us that we have lower soybean stocks, higher corn stocks than a year ago. Not a big shocker there either, right? Because we know that some of our viewers sold when prices were good in the soybean market.
Yeah, and that's historically what you see, too. And I think you'll see that this fall, too, from a new crop perspective. The good carry in the corn market, and farmers historically, you know, store corn both on farm and at the elevator, and they sell their beans out of the field. And that's the case this year. There's good carry in the corn market, pretty relatively strong basis for beans and no carry in the bean market, and strong yields. So I think you'll see that trend continue with selling beans and storing corn.
Speaking of yields, we are hearing some amazing soybean yields. Each week, I am just amazed at some of these reports that are coming out. Corn, a mixed bag. So what are you thinking as far as yield goes at this point, Brian?
Well, great question. Let's look at it in beans. Now, it's hard to estimate yield in beans. So when we look at rainfall totals in August, and then we look at what we saw in early September weather-wise, plant growth, everything that you put in the crop ratings, the potential is there. And so the key then is getting the feedback numbers from farmers, and they've been good. They have been as expected or better than expected across the board when we talk to producers. Corn, on the other hand, this is an ironic story, had everything going for it, but it seems to be a crop that's really dying of 1,000 cuts. And as farmers get into this, we continue to hear anywhere from 10 to 20 bushels less than expected. Yeah. They tell us it's not 2014. And so when we see an increase in acreage like we saw this year, at 174 yield, we don't buy it. Our numbers suggest somewhere in the mid-160s to low 170s.
Really?
You bet.
So if we could see this corn yield drop, and the soybean yield's probably going to go higher, do you think we've put a harvest low in on either of these crops, Chip?
Yeah, I think you have in corn. And that, just looking at the long-term historic seasonal tendency, whether you slice that by 5-year, 10-year, 30-year, when you turn the calendar to October, particularly once you get past the first week in October, historically, you've seen your harvest low in corn. So I think I agree with that. And I agree with Brian. Looks to me like the USDA could stand to cut corn yields going forward, maybe not dramatically, but just slowly but surely. So yeah, I think we're really close on, have seen it on corn. I'm not so sure yet on beans.
Considering the discussion of yield and stocks, what do we think about acreage next year? I know it's kind of early, but we're actually going to hit on that when we come back on U.S. Farm Report.
Receive a free trial of the Daily Market Letter and gain knowledge about current market conditions from the professionals at Bauer Trading. View the markets like never before. Go to BauerTrading.com.
There are no marks of conflict lining this landscape. No echoes of economic hardship. Just the unmistakable murmur of Mother Nature's hand. In the perennial quest to outperform, ensure your crop gets the nutrients it craves with Avail Phosphorus Fertilizer Enhancer. Nothing helps protect your investment more, so you can grow confidently no matter what comes your way. Avail, hold your ground.
Join Farm Journal for our annual Milk Business Conference on November 7th through the 9th in Las Vegas, Nevada. This 2-day conference, led by respected and knowledgeable industry experts, is filled with timely information for dairy operators. Topics include the global dairy market, consumer communication, the big question about GMOs, and a panel discussion. For more information, visit milkbusiness.com/events.
Catastrophic storms that can knock out power to millions. Powerful storms and high winds that bring down power lines. Even rolling blackouts caused by our nation's faltering electrical grid.
So how can you protect your home and family from all these uncertainties?
The answer is a home standby generator from Generac.
It stands guard, ready to automatically supply power to your home within seconds of a power outage. For a free buyer's guide and DVD all about Generac home backup power, call 1-800-394-1563. You'll learn all about automatic home generators starting at just $18.99. Online at freegeneratorguide.com.
It's one of the best investments I've ever made in this house.
It gives you security, it's reliable.
That gives you that feeling of security that, to me, is priceless.
Call now for a limited time bonus offer worth $495. That's 1-800-394-1563.
Welcome back. Well, when going back to that grain stocks report, when we see the massive stocks that we have in wheat going to pressure prices, I mean, you have to assume we're going to see fewer acres next year.
I think if we don't overcomplicate this equation, that's true. The question is, what will farmers do? And that was really what happened last year. We thought, well, corn acres will be down.
Right.
Then it boiled down to, well, what are farmers going to do? So it looks like there will be lower wheat acres. I think with especially the weather and fall the way it is, if guys can get the double crop in, that's another question. But I think it's more a financial issue. If we don't get an uprise in price in wheat, I just think wheat's a loser for the Midwest. Not necessarily the West or the South, but the Midwest.
I know the Plains have to plant wheat. I mean, that's pretty much some of their only option out in some of those areas. So realistically, how much could we see wheat acres drop?
Oh, I think it could easily be 1.5 million acres total. And I think going back to what Brian said earlier, you know, the old saying is the cure for low prices, low prices. So as prices go lower, you increase demand. And that has to be part of the function is you take out some of the more marginal acreage. And so that, to me, means that we could lose some corn acres as well. And I agree totally. I think, as you look at talk to bankers, there's a lot of concern about working capital shrinking on the balance sheet of farmers. And, I thought it would happen a little bit last year, but I really think the rubber will meet the road this year and the banker may kind of force some of that. So I could see more slightly uptick in bean acres, less corn acres, less wheat acres. Mm-hmm. Then it's up to, what's Mother Nature do for our growing season.
In the meantime, when we look at the stocks picture, I heard some folks say, listen, we can't afford a production hiccup anywhere, South America, here, anywhere, or else we're going to see prices shoot higher. Looking at these stocks, is that still the case?
I'm going to paint a fairly friendly picture for grains. Right now we're in the doldrums. We've got big crops. It's harvest. Yeah. But when you look at corn, we were talking again 2.4, 2.5 billion bushels of carryout a couple of months ago. Now it's 2.3. If yield comes down from 174, let's say down to 170, that takes our stocks and stocks usage numbers to levels that would equate to corn prices rallying over $4 in July or higher. So that stock number, that trend of stock, will continue to trend inward. We believe on our yield estimate models that we've published that the production number is probably closer to 168, and consequently that takes carryout down to about 17. If we look historically, the last 10 years, July corn futures have rallied at a minimum up to 435 after January 1st. So we've got 10 years of history that say, once we get through this harvest season, be a little more optimistic than what we're seeing right now.
Do you buy that?
Yeah, I think that's right in line. I don't disagree at all. We'll have to see what the final January crop report says, and probably more importantly, if the USDA is on that trend for lower corn yields on the October report. I agree totally, and I think assuming that bean, which I think is a safe assumption, that the demand from China is going to continue to be as good as it has been the last couple of years, yes, any little hiccup, we just can't sustain that. Any little weather problem in South America during our winter, you could easily get back north of $10.50 on beans.
Well, things to watch for, too, in Brazil right now, they will likely increase bean acreage. It'll be the lowest increase, however, in 10 years. So you've got record demand in both corn and beans worldwide. And if you're not maintaining or increasing your size of crop, there are going to be some consequences, and that's higher prices and rationing.
Speaking of production and demand, let's move to dairy real quick. World Dairy Expo next week in Wisconsin. Europe says they're slowing milk production. So it looks like possibly maybe this massive amount of dairy that we have on the world market, maybe that could be easing, but is that going to impact price at all, Brian?
Cow slaughter for dairy producers, it's an enigma. It was only down 2%, and most analysts were looking for 6 to 8% here this summer. Higher prices in midsummer kept production active here in the U.S., so even if Europe decreases some, we've got a production here issue here in the U.S. yet.
All right, thank you both. We'll get your closing thoughts when we come back on U.S. Farm Report.
Are you paying too much for your cable or satellite TV? The U.S. government passed a bill mandating free over-the-air digital transmission of all broadcast network television channels. That means with the new TV Freeway digital antenna, you can get free HD programming from your favorite broadcast networks 24/7 without a bill. You just plug it into the back of your TV and start watching all of your favorite broadcast programs for free. There are no contracts to sign, no hidden fees, and no monthly fees. Just free HD broadcast TV. Take it with you anywhere. Call or go online now to get your TV Freeway stick for the incredibly low price of only $14.99. But wait, call or click now and you can get a second TV Freeway stick for a second TV. Just pay a separate fee, but you have to order right now.
Call 1-800-316-1198 to get your TV Freeway. Call now or go to tvfreeway.com. So call 1-800-316-1198. Call now.
Attention women with ovarian cancer. If you or a loved one were diagnosed with or died from ovarian cancer and frequently use baby powder or other talcum products, you may be entitled to money damages. Call 800-803-6721. Medical studies have linked the long-term use of talcum products with ovarian cancer. Some talc-based powders may contain cancer-causing ingredients, and millions of women may have been unknowingly exposed to these toxic substances. If you or a loved one frequently use baby powder or other talcum products and were later diagnosed with or died from ovarian cancer, you may be entitled to money damages. Call 800-803-6721. Recently, one manufacturer of talcum powder was ordered to pay $72 million by a jury to a woman who died of ovarian cancer after years of using the manufacturer's talc products. Act now, as time is limited to file a claim. Call Goza Honnold now for a free consultation. Call 800-803-6721. That's 800-803-6721. Call now, 800-803-6721.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report. Closing thoughts, Chip Mellinger. We'll start with you.
Yeah, I think Brian and I both agree that there's some good long-term potential for corn and beans. Even though it's busy right now, you still have to plan that out. What are you going to do when prices rally? How are you going to merchandise that? How are you going to take account of basis and spreads? So now, even though it's busy with harvest, is the time to be planning what we're going to do with the rest of our old crop and then new crop as well.
All right. Brian?
Well, it's an election year. Obama ran on hope and change. I'm going to run this year on hope and balance. And what I mean by that is we've got low prices now, but we've got some really good demand things going in place or that are in place that are going to impact price. And so the idea of higher prices extending beyond $4 in corn and beyond $10 or $11 in beans isn't likely. But when they get to those levels, you're going to get a little more bullish. Make sure that you market that grain. Utilize your option strategies, but be balanced in your approach so you don't get caught like the last 2 years when prices tipped over. It was devastating how quick they went down.
Yeah, good advice. Thank you both. John Phipps joins us next.
With market prices constantly changing, it's important to know where current prices stand. Get market prices delivered right to your mobile phone. Just text MARKETS8 to 31313 to get started.
Can Bosley regrow your hair?
This is my own growing hair that I can comb, cut, style, do whatever I want with.
The results I've achieved have been exceptional. This is my real hair. I can do with it whatever I want. This is mine.
Bosley gave me my hair back. I cut this hair. I wash this hair. I mess this hair up if I want to mess this hair up.
I can't explain to you the way that it made me feel to be able to wear my hair down, go out on a date, and have confidence again.
Can Bosley regrow your hair?
This is my hair. This is my hair.
Call or go online for your free, no-obligation self-evaluation kit. Plus, call in the next 6 minutes, and we'll even send you this $250 gift certificate. The information is free, so choose to grow back your own real hair. Choose Bosley. Call now.
If it's your kid asking, it's annoying. If it's a billion people across the globe, it's a challenge and responsibility. Farmers feeding the world. It's about agriculture coming together to increase both hunger solutions and food production. Please learn more and give generously.
This is an important medical announcement regarding the prescription blood thinner Xarelto. If you or a loved one has been hospitalized or died from serious internal bleeding, including bleeding of the brain or gastrointestinal system after taking Xarelto, you may be entitled to substantial compensation. Time may be limited to file a claim, so don't delay. Call Xarelto Relief Line now. Our network of experienced attorneys is ready to fight for you. Call Xarelto Relief Line now.
Please call 800-970-0580.
Well, we already mentioned Iowa's deluge of rain last week. It also sparked John's commentary this week. John?
Well, as you can see, we're adding more drainage to our farm. My experience on our heavy soils is drainage pays back in a big way, just not all that fast. Just like most of my career was dependent on drainage system installed over a century ago by hand, somebody decades from now will benefit from this work. The recent downpours in Iowa around Cedar Rapids reinforce my worry that big rain events will affect all the Corn Belt more often. But on our farm, wet years have a disproportionately large negative impact. The problem, of course, is the considerable initial cost. With returns to farmland dropping as commodity prices plummet, fewer owners and operators will be able to make this type of investment. That said, I don't think there's been a moment in my career when any badly needed investment looked like a bargain. There's another issue as well. System drainage, like we're installing here, changes how our farm adds to nutrient runoff. Environmentally, it works both ways. Well-drained soil can absorb and more slowly release runoff water after a big rain by acting more like a sponge than a parking lot. Our hope is we will decrease our soil losses this way, which in turn directly determines the amount of phosphate that leaves the farm. On the other hand, better drainage can make our farm more sensitive to nitrogen runoff if the timing and the nature of the application is not managed well. Those ugly, long-standing ponds and fields may be detrimental to yields, but they do act as mini wetlands to delay and decrease the nitrogen entering the watershed. There is considerable research underway to try to balance these two objectives. Cultural practices like cover crops and split applications seem to help, but don't currently look like the whole answer. If I had to guess, I would say Aaron may be working with neighbors to create man-made wetlands at our tile outlets in the future in order to preserve downstream water quality. With larger and more frequent rain events for all of us, drainage will become a bigger farming headache for more farmers. At the same time, we cannot ignore our obligations to those downstream.
All right, thanks, John. Well, we've all heard where Trump stands on immigration and trade, but what about other key issues in ag, like EPA's WOTUS rule? We'll find out after the break.
U.S. Farm Report is produced and distributed by Farm Journal Broadcast. From the studios of Farm Journal Broadcast, this is U.S. Farm Report.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report this weekend. We have much more ahead. As the trade debate heats up, agriculture is making their case for why trade talk, it needs action. It's a battle made famous by a popular song in the 1950s. And could autonomous equipment cause the fall of family farms? That's customer support. Now for the headlines, 2016 net farm income could top what Illinois farmers saw in 2015. The University of Illinois releasing their updated 2016 outlook this week. Economists say considering the record-setting yields many are seeing, that could lead to higher soybean returns. And when you take into consideration that non-land costs and cash rents have fallen, the economists think the higher soybean returns could cause improved net farm incomes this year. But the U of I economists warn that crop budgets suggest very low returns and net farm incomes in 2017. Iowa farmland values are on the decline. A new survey from the Iowa chapter of Realtors Land Institute showing the average price per acre in the state is around $6,486. That's an 8.7% drop from September of last year and a 25% decline from the peak we saw in 2013. Landowner editor Mike Walston expects that rapid decline in Iowa to slow this year.
As the grain market starts to find some stability and the market adjusts, it looks like that this farmland market is starting to find some stability in the Iowa side. Over in Illinois, land values are holding steady, but with a weaker favor.
Walston says it could be another year before the Eastern Corn Belt land values find that floor. Well, the first presidential debate took place this week. Other than immigration and trade, ag really didn't receive much attention. But this week, our partners at AgriTalk had a one-on-one interview with Donald Trump's ag advisor, Sam Clovis. Host Mike Adams pressed Clovis on immigration reform, saying some estimates point to 50% of ag's workforce being here illegally. Clovis defended Trump's stance on immigration, saying there can be no exceptions.
And we will work with farmers and ranchers to make sure that we have the best possible process in place that satisfies both the notion of having a usable and workable workforce in this country, at the same time having people here legally so that we can establish the rule of law in this country.
And on the topic of EPA overreach, well, Clovis says the Trump campaign plans to appoint a farmer or rancher as the head of the Environmental Protection Agency. And from day one, each government agency will take a look at the rules written in the last 5 years, immediately eliminating 20% of those. More than 500,000 farmers can now join the lawsuit against Syngenta after a Kansas federal judge says the class action suit against the company may move forward. The plaintiffs allege Syngenta prematurely sold its AgriSure Viptera and Duracade corn products, leading China to stop importing the corn, which in turn caused prices to dip. The first case could make it before a judge in June of 2017. All right, that's it for the news. Meteorologist Mike Hoffman joins us again this week with his 90-day. Mike, how's moisture looking?
Thanks, Ty. And as you'll see in my moisture outlook for the next 90 days, some northern areas I'm still expecting above normal precipitation, southern sections, at least parts of the area, expected to be below normal. Now, as far as the jet stream this week, that slow-moving storm system still in the eastern Great Lakes, that finally gets completely out of our hair by Wednesday as a ridge builds into the northeast. But look at that, another cutoff coming into the southwestern plains, southeastern Rockies. And as we head through the week, our model is showing that kind of cutting off into the southern Mississippi Valley. That'll be producing at least some shower activity down that way with a trough farther north. It does finally get rid of that. Then you can kind of see a zonal flow with ripples through it as we head into Sunday. Now, let's go 90 days, month by month. October temperatures above normal in much of the country. Southern plains near normal. November, much of the country as well, with northern and central plains near normal. Then on to December, looks like colder air starts to come into the northern plains and the Great Lakes. As far as precipitation is concerned, around the Great Lakes and the Pacific Northwest, expected to be above normal over the next 90 days. Tyne?
Thanks so much, Mike. Well, the leading presidential candidates have made one thing clear. They aren't in favor of trade deals like the Trans-Pacific Partnership. This week, Sam Clovis told Mike Adams the TPP isn't transparent and flooded with labor issues, not to mention problems with WTO compliance. But as I explained in this Farm Journal report, that's not the popular opinion of agriculture.
As the two presidential hopefuls went head-to-head in their first debate, trade was caught in the middle.
The facts are, I did say I hoped it would be a good deal, but when it was negotiated, which I was not responsible for, I concluded it wasn't. I wrote about that.
So is it President Obama's fault?
While views differ on the campaign trail, to many in agriculture, trade is a main lifeline for ag goods.
About 20% of all the volume of all ag products grown in the United States are exported, about 30% by value.
And as more products are shipped, American Farm Bureau says it's having a direct impact on the U.S. economy.
USDA estimates that for every additional $1 billion in ag exports, we add about 7,500 jobs in the United States.
Today, trade may be a buzzword, but for corn growers, it's something they would like to see grow.
If you look at the world, there's hundreds of trade agreements, and the U.S. is in about 20. And so we have very few trade agreements.
We're very focused on TPP. It would be absolutely huge for the U.S. pork industry.
We've estimated that it'll add $4.4 billion to net farm income in the United States each year.
Nye says while the agreement involves 11 other countries, there's one that stands out the most.
Probably the biggest fish among those 11 is Japan, which is already our fourth largest export market. But there's a lot of room to grow. Japan has a lot of high tariffs on a number of products that the United States specializes in.
She says the United States currently faces a 39% tax on beef exports to Japan, but through TPP, that would drop to 9%. Meanwhile, as wheat prices hit a 10-year low, wheat growers say TPP could help give prices some life.
It would allow us to gain better access into Korea with some tariffs that are in place now that are really stopping us ability to be a competitive exporter into that market.
But it's more than just those 11 other TPP countries along the Pacific Rim that's attractive to agriculture.
We have supply, ample supply. We have ample quality supply. We don't have the demand that we need.
Today, Mexico and Central America are the top buyers of U.S. rice, but Sullivan says if China would start buying, that would be a game changer.
Based on the consumption rates of rice in China, in a 14-day period, they could eat the entire U.S. crop.
It's more than just rice looking to China to pick up demand.
China really has a shortage on pork products, so their domestic production is down. They've had a lot of challenges in importing product.
China is already the top buyer of U.S. soybeans, but balancing that demand is a concern for American Soybean Association.
25% of the soybeans raised in the United States go to China. So if there's some kind of a political hiccup, they're going to reduce what they buy from the United States. So we have to continue to be active in other markets globally to make sure that if that happens, we can still move our soybeans into the marketplace.
No matter the destination, many ag groups say we need to grow demand.
Domestic consumption is strong, but virtually flat. And even with the amount of product, even if our consumers were to consume 2 more pounds of pork a year, that would not compensate for the amount of pork we're going to have on the market.
But at one time, you know, we were growing exports by 10 and 20% per year in some years, and that just isn't happening anymore.
But not everyone in agriculture is a fan of trade, saying it's a double-edged sword.
Everybody wants to ship to us. We're not exporting any sugar. So for us, you know, we would just as soon temper all of these agreements. And if you want to trade something with someone else, that's fine. But you could leave us out. We'd be happy with that.
Sugar beet growers say they aren't against current trade deals, knowing many areas of ag benefit. But when other countries subsidize production, undercutting the U.S. price, that's when groups like Sugar and Rice say some deals are unjust.
We do know is that we want to create a level playing field. And anytime that another country is allowed to subsidize and then export, we know that that's not fair to our growers.
Next week, we'll tackle another issue discussed frequently on the campaign trail, NAFTA. What would life be like without it? We'll have the answer next week. Well, up next, John Phipps.
Introducing the all-new DR Leaf and Lawn Vacuum, now at our lowest price ever. The DR cleans up acres of leaves and grass while you mow. In the spring, collect dead grass, wet leaves, and twigs from storm damage. Come summer, the DR makes a great high-capacity bagger, and in the fall, turns days of raking into a drive in the park. When it's time to unload, nothing could be easier. Look, just one hand. Plus, with the collector top removed, you've got a rugged utility cart that's great for all kinds of hauling chores. The DR is the most powerful, most versatile lawn machine you can buy.
Call 1-800-718-7570 for your free buyer's guide and DVD. Learn how you can try a DR at home for a full year. Payments start as low as $37 a month, and free shipping is now in effect. That's 1-800-718-7570. Online at drleafvac.com.
Are you being denied credit or paying high interest rates? Your credit score could be the problem. You need Credit Repair Pros, where we work directly with the credit bureaus and your creditors to challenge inaccurate information on your credit report to help you transform your credit score into the one you need to get the things you want, like a new car, a new home, even a new job. Call Credit Repair Pros to speak with a credit expert and find out how we'll work to improve your credit by helping remove inaccurate items from your credit reports. For over 15 years, we've helped thousands resolve their credit issues, and we've helped remove over 500,000 negative items, like charge-offs, late payments, foreclosures, even bankruptcies. So don't wait. Call Credit Repair Pros today and start rebuilding your future. Credit Repair Pros, where great credit begins. Call now for your free credit consultation. Credit experts are standing by.
Call 1-800-648-5633. That's 1-800-648-5633.
Case IH's new autonomous tractor stole the show at Farm Progress this year, even causing John to cover it in John's World. And it drew a lot of questions and comments from many of you. Here's John.
Your call is very important to us. Please hold.
My comments about autonomous tractors a couple weeks ago started many of you thinking. These thoughts from Paul Seehaber in Virginia. Interesting report on driverless technology. It would seem inevitable, yet concerning. It could hasten the demise of the family farm. Picture larger conglomerates that buy or lease larger tracts of land, then have a control room full of tractor operators plowing, planting, and picking, much like a railroad dispatch center at farms across the nation. Paul, thanks for writing. Send me an address. This harvest out on the grain cart, I've tried to imagine how this technology could impact our own farm. First, I'm always suspicious about predictions of doom for family farms. They seem remarkably adaptable and durable, and I think land ownership patterns override many factors pushing greater consolidation. Despite fears for my entire career, family farms have slowly gotten bigger rather than abruptly disappearing. Second, autonomous tractors would seem to be adaptable to the large contiguous tracts of land. Remember, that video showed a wheat field in what appeared to be that part of the country where farmers talk about quarters rather than acres. But this technology is scale neutral. There's no reason there could not be 150 horsepower autonomous tractors, especially because of the familiar price curve for technology. While the first units may be pricey, recent history suggests a rapid decline as competition and other innovation comes to bear. There will be a proximity premium, I think. In other words, with autonomous tractors, the land right next to your farm becomes even more valuable to rent or own. Autonomous tractors could help multi-county strung-out operations less than more compact farms. The uneven demand for labor on grain farms is one of the biggest hurdles for smaller operators. Just one modestly sized autonomous tractor could be more of a competitive breakthrough than a threat. This technology looks to me to be size neutral or even smaller farmer friendly if other electronic advances are any guide.
Thanks, John. And don't forget, if you have questions or comments, you can email John or send us a note on Facebook or Twitter. Well, when we come back, we have the story about a popular hit from the 1950s. American Countryside is next.
The desire to bring real-world solutions to growers' difficult production challenges has led Bayer to introduce Credenz, our national brand of soybean seed, backed by years of research in smart genetics. Smart genetics is based on four concepts.
State-of-the-art breeding
allows Bayer to identify key traits and characteristics that bring value and protection to your soybean production situation. Next is herbicide-tolerant traits. The flexibility of multiple trait platforms allows growers to pick the most effective weed control system for their farm. Next is tailored varieties. With a robust portfolio, Credenz offers many solutions for difficult situations that you may experience, along with our best-in-class agronomic service team to support variety selection. And last is ongoing innovation. Bayer is continuing to invest in ways to improve yields and increase the profitability on your farm.
Attention homeowners. Quicken Loans has some very important information regarding the U.S. government's Home Affordable Refinance Program, or HARP. Nearly 3 million homeowners have already taken advantage of this fantastic money-saving program. But there are so many more of you who could be saving hundreds of dollars every month on your mortgage. Quicken Loans is here to help you save money. Why Quicken Loans? The home loan experts at Quicken Loans fully understand the HARP guidelines. We'll work with you to understand your specific circumstances and strive to find the financial solution that's best for you. Then we'll guide you through each step of the mortgage refinance process to make sure that it's both simple and easy. If you weren't HARP eligible in the past, new guidelines could mean that now you are. Give us a call and we'll give you a Quicken Loans mortgage review. It's simple and easy. To learn more about this money-saving U.S. government program, call Quicken Loans today or go to quickenloans.com for a mortgage experience that's engineered to amaze.
Some people claim that music has lost its meaning over time, but you can't make that claim about a hit from the 1950s. In fact, you can argue it's what made a battle from the 1800s so famous. Andrew McRae tells the story in this week's American Countryside.
It was December of 1814, and the British were closing in on the city of New Orleans, forcing a battle with the young United States. The southern city was a mix of nationalities and loyalties, a melting pot that might support either nation. That was the challenge facing the now famous general when he arrived to defend the local citizens.
Andrew Jackson gave this impassioned speech on Jackson Square, asking the citizens of New Orleans to let go of their cultural differences and unite in a national emergency. And to his surprise and to the governor's surprise, they did.
Jackson assembled a truly multicultural force. Free men of color made up a third of the city's population and were a vital part of his group, along with those of a variety of other backgrounds.
He reached out to Choctaw Indians who had fought with him in other battles during the Creek Wars and the War of 1812, and they joined forces with him. He reached out to the French and Spanish in the city of New Orleans and a large Irish contingent. And he also brought in Jean Lafitte and the Baratarian Pirates.
As 1814 turned to 1815, the British assembled south of the city, preparing for an attack. But if not for a teacher named Jimmy Driftwood, the average American would perhaps know little about the battle that took place here. In 1936, Driftwood wrote a song about the event to help his students learn more about it. Johnny Horton later recorded it into a hit.
In 1814, we took a little trip
at Chalmette Plantation, just outside the city.
He really liked this spot because it was a narrow point between the Mississippi River right over there and the swamps right over there. And he felt that if he had this narrow point, he could build a rampart connecting the swamp to the river levee and set up a barricade and stop the British right here.
We fired our guns and the British kept coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago.
Although the Americans were outnumbered 2-1, Jackson's men stood their ground. The battle lasted but 2 hours, and the young nation won the last major battle of the War of 1812. Jimmy Horton's song hit number one in 1959. The details of the battle, put to music, are still catchy lyrics today.
The briars and the brambles were really something that factored into this battle. When you think about the British coming here, they didn't expect the landscape or the wetscape to be like it was.
Yeah, they ran through the briars and they ran through the brambles and they ran through the bushes where a rabbit couldn't go.
While it's not the birthplace of the nation, it may just be another beginning in the nation's history.
A lot of historians feel that this is the location of the birthplace of the American identity because of the way that the American forces came together and defended the city of New Orleans.
Although the events of this battlefield are now over two centuries old, it's still a place Americans know, whether through song or through the general that led those American forces. It's a battle that still resonates with Americans today. Traveling the countryside in St. Bernard Parish, Louisiana, I'm Andrew McRae.
Thanks, Andrew. You can hear more of his stories by downloading the Farm Journal radio and television apps. Well, next up, Machinery Pete has this week's Tractor Tales.
Find your next piece of machinery with the most trusted name in farm equipment. MachineryPete.com has more than 100,000 pieces of machinery listed for sale from thousands of dealers across the country. It's the fastest site to find and value your next piece of used equipment. Shop with the most trusted name in farm equipment at MachineryPete.com.
Join Farm Journal for our annual Milk Business Conference on November 7th through the 9th in Las Vegas, Nevada. This two-day conference, led by respected and knowledgeable industry experts, is filled with timely information for dairy operators. Topics include the global dairy market, consumer communication, the big question about GMOs, and a panel discussion. For more information, visit milkbusiness.com/events.
Attention homeowners, taking a bath in your high wall tub is an accident waiting to happen. But now, you can turn your existing tub or shower into a safe, easy entry tub in just one day. With no tub walls to climb over, just open the door and walk right in, and the raised safety seat lets you bathe in comfort. Our easy entry tubs are made in the USA with vital safety features like a slip-resistant floor, ultra-low threshold, and watertight door with lifetime warranty. Now you can enjoy the healing benefits of water therapy safely and easily.
I use it for everything, for bathing, for relaxing, and I don't have to worry.
So stop risking injury when you bathe. Our affordable, easy entry tubs offer you the best safety value and service with factory trained installation in just one day. For a limited time, save $1,500 and be one of the first 100 callers to get a free gift with purchase.
Call 1-800-581-6578. That's 1-800-581-6578.
Time now for Tractor Tales with Machinery Pete, the most trusted name in farm equipment.
We farm here in Ashcombe, my dad and my brother and I. Always kind of been equipment enthusiasts. We got some of Grandpa's old tractors and just kind of have grown. My Grandpa's dad was a big international guy. We actually have John Deere equipment that we farm with, but I kind of got into internationals about 15 years ago, and I've got about 8 internationals. Bought it from a gentleman up in Minnesota. The Wheatland tractors aren't really popular in this part of the country. And I guess I'm kind of a goof and kind of like some odd stuff or different stuff that people don't always have. This is the condition I bought it in. It was restored, and sometimes we fix some of them up ourselves, and sometimes you get lucky and find them the way you want them. And my brother's into Olivers, and we got some Alice Chelmers, and we kind of had a little of everything over the years, but I kind of like the Wheatlands, and really, how can you not like a 1206? So we'll parade them in tractor shows and that type of deal, and we had it in a parade just yesterday, actually. It's a little bit unique for the area, being a Wheatland, and people are pretty impressed with it, and I get a lot of thumbs up at tractor shows, and that old 70-year-old guy in an international hat, I get a lot of this, and that just makes my day. It makes me think of my grandpa, and pretty cool. Got a set of 24-5-32 rear rims and centers that are would be factory with that tractor, and it probably should have had wide tires, a lot of them would have, and I was eventually going to switch out. Yeah, I'm pretty partial to the 1206. It's just an impressive looking tractor. Always wanted one since I was a little kid.
Thanks so much. Well, this week's Country Church Salute goes to the Newburgh Congregational Church in Hettinger County, North Dakota. Now, it's a very remote church, nearly 25 miles from the nearest town. It was an abandoned church on the brink of being burned down, but they tell me that three men actually stepped up, refurbishing the church with new paint inside and out and countless repairs. And as you can see, from 2014 to today, well, the church received quite the facelift. Our thanks to Veronica Klein for sharing their story. If you have a church that you would like to share, you can do that to the address on the screen. Well, stay with us. We have harvest photos next.
How's it going?
Hi.
Today we're going to be comparing the roll-formed, high-strength steel bed of the Chevy Silverado to the aluminum bed of this competitor's truck.
Awesome.
All right, let him drop. Let's see how the aluminum bed of this truck held up.
Wow.
That's a good-sized puncture.
That's all the way through, for sure.
Full-on crack here.
If you're aluminum now, you're going to go, ooh.
Let's check out the Silverado steel bed.
Wow.
Yeah, a couple dents.
I'd expect more dents.
Chevy clearly held up better than the Ford.
You're driven. You refuse to settle. You're a farmer, and you are relentless. We're relentless too. So we promise to never stop, never settle, never ever back down from a challenge, because we know you won't.
Are you paying too much for your cable or satellite TV? The U.S. government passed a bill mandating free over-the-air digital transmission of all broadcast network television channels. That means with the new TV Freeway digital antenna, you can get free HD programming from your favorite broadcast networks 24/7 without a bill. You just plug it into the back of your TV and start watching all of your favorite broadcast programs for free. There are no contracts to sign, no hidden fees, and no monthly fees. Just free HD broadcast TV. Take it with you anywhere. Call or go online now to get your TV Freeway stick for the incredibly low price of only $14.99. But wait, call or click now and you can get a second TV Freeway stick for a second TV. Just pay a separate fee, but you have to order right now.
Call 1-800-316-1198 to get your TV Freeway. Call now or go to tvfreeway.com. So call 1-800-316-1198. Call now.
Welcome back. Well, as we kick off this first weekend of October, we have some harvest from the farm. Jake Michael put together this short clip of them harvesting corn the other day. Now, thank goodness for drones, Mike, because they produce the coolest harvest footage.
That is really cool.
For us to use. So far, USDA showing 15% of Indiana's corn crop is in the bin, a point ahead of average. And as you can see down near southern Indiana, soybeans, they are about ready to be harvested as well.
And Tyne, what a great sunset shot from Kirby Lichty of Lexington, Missouri. She tells us they actually wrapped up corn harvest this week and should start on soybeans soon. Yields have been great this year and harvest weather is cooperating. Some early season showers had farmers nervous in that area, but she says since then, Mother Nature has cooperated, allowing them to get the crop out on time.
And in South Dakota and North Dakota, Dwayne Bussey, who is a market analyst that we've frequently have on our show. He says, Mike, yields in his area, amazing. I mean, we're talking 10, 15 bushels better than average on soybeans. So he is counting his blessings this year for harvest.
Well, when you really look at the drought monitor and crop moisture, and it's looked pretty good most of the year across the Corn Belt.
Yeah, and some of those areas up north, they did get too much rain. I know they had to plow some of those fields under early, but for those others, they're definitely having an amazing harvest this year. For all of us at U.S. Farm Report, thank you so much for watching. Be sure to join us again right here next week as we work to build on our tradition. Have a great weekend and a safe harvest, everyone.
High-strength steel for high-strength dependability. Chevy Silverado, the official news gathering vehicle of U.S. Farm Report. U.S. Farm Report is produced and distributed by Farm Journal Broadcast.